Welcome to Touring with the Candidates, sponsored by the Santa Barbara League of Women Voters Education Fund. Each of the two candidates for First District Santa Barbara County Supervisor will have up to 15 minutes to take you on a tour of his or her district. The itinerary and commentary is up to each candidate. The program is filmed and produced by Larry Nimmer. Let's watch the first candidate.
Well, hello.
Hi, Larry. How are you? I'm Salud Carbajal, running for re-election for county supervisor.
Nice to see you.
Good to see you. Come on in.
Thanks for having me.
You're very welcome. This is my wife, Gina.
Nice to see you, Gina.
Nice to see you.
And what part of town are we in here, Salud?
We are on the west side of the city of Santa Barbara, on Islay Street, to be exact.
And I've been here before with other
Yes, teams. You have.
Well, nice to see you. Shall we go?
Yes, let's get going.
Okay, here we
Great.
Go.
We'll see you shortly, Gina. Larry, this is the west side near my home. And the reason we're going through here is I just wanted you to get a sense of this neighborhood. It's in the city of Santa Barbara. Certainly, it's within the authority of the city council, not the Board of Supervisors, in terms of its direct municipal services. But nonetheless, we are working, my office and the county of Santa Barbara is working with the city of Santa Barbara and the schools to see what we could do better together by collaborating to bring more resources and services to the west side of Santa Barbara as well as the east side. These are underserved neighborhoods, and collaborating, interagency collaboration, I think, lends itself to maximizing our resources and being able to be more effective in addressing the needs of this area. And that's what we're doing right now.
Okay, where are we now, Salud?
Well, Larry, now we're here in the San Roque area. It's the new part of the district since redistricting. Here's McKenzie Park. And of course, the first district stems from the San Roque area, all the way down to, in the city of Santa Barbara, all the way down to the city of Carpinteria. And the new part of the district, it was New Cuyama was added to it, as well as San Roque, and a little piece of the waterfront. And so this is all new, a new section and a new area that was included now in the first district. It really doesn't mean much to people's lives other than they have a new representative, and that is now myself. So it's, I'm looking forward to representing the interests, the needs of the residents of San Roque as well, and providing the highest level of customer service when people call my office. Larry, here we're in a green space that's pretty much in the center of San Roque. And it's, I think, one of the areas in San Roque that characterizes the San Roque area. So, again, this is a new part of the district, and I'm just really excited to be able to represent the individuals and the families and the households here in San Roque. Two other communities in the first district are the Riviera and Mission Canyon.
Is this Mission Canyon here?
This is Mission Canyon area. And it's a high fire hazard area, and many of the residents up here have great concerns about their safety and fire safety. And that's one of the areas that I think county government has really done everything possible to address the needs of the community, is to work with the community in partnership to have a good plan to address fire safety in the area. We also have a community plan going on right now that addresses parking and circulation and all the various issues that are covered by a community plan. And that is going to be concluded in a few months. And that is something that we've been working on for over a year now. And I think it's going to improve the quality of life for residents in Mission Canyon greatly. Larry, and here as we come up to Fire Station 15 at the county, it's the fire station that serves this entire region of Mission Canyon area. And clearly it's well situated to address the fire needs and the response to all these issues here in Mission Canyon. And I thought it's important to come by here and just be able to point this out. And Larry, here we're in the east side part of the city of Santa Barbara. That's also in my district. And of course, I represent the area that includes the Mission, and it's a very iconic place here in Santa Barbara. And my son's school is Roosevelt School, and it's right over here across the street. And we're going to go by there right now. But again, this is in the heart of the east side, upper east side. And we're going to go to the lower part of the east side right now on Milpa Street. And Larry, here's a school, Roosevelt School, that I pointed out, which is a school where my son goes to school at. His name is Michael, and he is 11 years old.
Okay, we're recording. Where are we now?
And Larry, we're on Milpa Street, and as you know, this is again in the city of Santa Barbara, the lower east side. And again, the city provides municipal services in the incorporated area. And the county provides full services and municipal services for the unincorporated area. But even in the city areas, we provide a number of services, social services, health services, to the residents, whether you're in the incorporated or unincorporated area. And here we're gonna go to the Eastside County Health Clinic to illustrate, I think, some of the services that the county does directly provide in incorporated city areas such as the city of Santa Barbara. And again, the city provides its municipal services for roads and law enforcement here in the city, but the county also provides ample services to city residents. And here's the Franklin Neighborhood Center, and also the Public Health Franklin Clinic. And we're gonna get off right now. And Larry, here we're in front of the County Public Health Clinic here in the city of Santa Barbara, Lower East Side. And the county is required to provide health care to all residents, incorporated and unincorporated area, and that is to residents who can't afford traditional health insurance. And I'm also very proud to say that Santa Barbara County was able to provide insurance to most uninsured children in the county of Santa Barbara. We went from 16,000 uninsured children to just slightly under 2,000 here in the county. And that's something I'm very proud of and something I worked hard to achieve.
Okay, we're on. Where are we going now?
We are getting on the 101 freeway from Milpas and Milpas Street. And this is just basically an opportunity to talk about how we have a major widening project that's ensuing, that's about to come to conclusion here on the Cabrillo Hot Springs area. But there's two other major phases going on that will come forward in the near future. And again, we're trying to bring about a rail, commuter rail project from Ventura all the way to Goleta. And we're working on continuing the widening project with the SBCAG and the State of California Caltrans from Montecito to Casitas Pass in Carpinteria. And the other phase, which is already starting, is the Casitas Pass to Muscle Shoals in Ventura County. Measure A is going to help us build the widening project from Montecito all the way to Casitas Pass. It's $425 million. Measure A was able to provide $140 million of that. And we are on our way. Larry, we are here now entering Montecito on San Isidro Road. And here we have a path that is in keeping with the rural character of Montecito that the county was able to build, working with residents and stakeholders and school, the school of Montecito Union and parents. And it was a little controversial at first. People were concerned that it not looked like a sidewalk, that it looked like a rural pathway, so that it could be in keeping with the character of Montecito and the community plan. And we were able to achieve a very good outcome.
Is that crushed granite?
That is decomposed granite that was used, and it's really a nice looking trail, as you can see. Larry, as you can see, the path turned out really great, and it's great for pedestrians, children's safety, and now we have a lot of people that are children and adults that are just using this pathway to make sure that they can traverse this area in a very safe manner. And I'm very proud of how it turned out. The Montecito community has worked hard with the county to maintain the character of the community through its community plan and good land use policies. And I think we've achieved that greatly in part because of the civic engagement from the community.
Go ahead.
Larry here, we're entering another community in the first district, Summerlin. As you can see, the big yellow house is being renovated. And here we have the parking and circulation plan that we've implemented over the years. We're in the process of concluding the downtown revitalization as it relates to the parking and circulation plan. We're in the last phase of it right now. And we're also in the process of concluding the community plan for Summerlin, which again, has done a really good job of putting forth policies that the community themselves have identified are needed for the community. And again, it's going to improve the quality of life for residents in Summerlin. And it's been a great partnership with the county bringing these projects forward. The Summerlin Community Plan, which will conclude in the near future, and the Parking and Circulation Plan. Larry here, we're at Santa Claus Lane, and we have a big project planned for this area with the community to provide safe beach passage for residents and area residents who visit this wonderful beach. It's one of the highest used beaches in our county, and it doesn't have safe passage. And we're working with the state PUC to provide an ag-grade crossing. The county has two parcels here where we're going to be able to provide that safe passage. We're working with the area residents and the business owners to provide a better parking and circulation plan for this entire vicinity and give it a new aesthetic, revitalized feel to it. So this is an area that we're working on aggressively. We're also going to have amenities like restrooms that are not existent right now, but so that people could use the facilities when they come visit this beach. Currently, those facilities are lacking, and those are the types of things we're going to be working on with the Santa Claus project. We are now at the Carpinteria Resource Center at Main, and I'm very proud that we have weekly office hours here in Carpinteria. And we've had it for going on 8 years, and it's been a great way to be accessible and to connect with Carpinteria residents. We have also brought a variety of county resources and services to the Carpinteria community. In addition to our health clinic, we have a number of health and human services programs here in this facility, and I'm very proud of that. It's something we've achieved working with the Carpinteria community. Larry, we're here at the Carpinteria Bluffs, which is the southernmost part of the First District. And this property was acquired by the community. They came together to purchase it. And the county was a small piece in partnering with the community to make that happen as well through CREF funding. And I'm very proud to represent this community. We're also working in partnership with the community for the Franklin Trail and making these treasures exist for future generations. And I think it's part of the values that I have, and I think that the residents of the First District have. Being a son of a farm worker also allows me to appreciate the farm workers that we have in this community, as well as the significant agriculture community. We have one of the most significant cut flower ag sectors in the country here in this area, and I am very proud to be able to represent them as well. As you can see, we have a diverse district, and the county has been doing a lot to improve the lives and quality of life of our residents, and I'm very proud to be your supervisor. I respectfully ask for your support on June 5th. You can go to my website at saludcarbajal.com.
Okay, well, good luck to you, Salud.
Thank you, Larry.
Hi, I'm Larry Nimmer, the producer and cameraman of Touring with the Candidates. Let's watch the second tour.
I was an art dealer for 25 years, and I think after the first 10 years, I just sort of started to get a feel for it, and I studied it a lot. I probably studied different markets, and I knew that I couldn't afford the really best paintings by de Kooning and people like that, so I looked for markets that hadn't been developed yet.
Okay.
Almost like in the stock market, it would be equivalent to an emerging market. And I started buying photography when no one thought it was a collectible or that it was important at all. And so I bought photographs extremely inexpensively. And I turned out to be right.
Shall we move on?
Well, I hope they don't run away. Okay, that's Miss America is on the left. She's an American short hair, and I think she's with child. And the one on the right is a rescue cat I got at Viva up in Lompoc. And he's the best cat kill, best rat killer in the world.
Thank you.
You're on TV, honey. But I used to have a terrible rat problem. And since I got the two rescue cats, there are no rats.
What part of town do you live in?
I live in Montecito.
Well, should we move on?
Yeah. Okay, come on back, and I'm going to show you some golden oldies that you'll remember from the 60s. And do you know who this is?
Is that R. Crumb?
It is. And this was another artist. These are original cartoon strips from the 60s. These are the original drawings that became, that you would have seen in comic books and things like that. This one is really, really kind of lascivious. If you read it, it's sort of, you see where the cats are. And this was a funny one. I got that because I was an art dealer. And then this is a really rare one. This was done in Harlem. He did a whole series of drawings in Harlem, and these are some of his earliest published works. But these were things that, again, when I couldn't afford to buy the really fancy paintings, this was somebody else that I identified a long time ago and thought that it would be a good investment. And I also liked it. I liked the work. And I turned out to be right on that too. So,
did you earn your own money? Or?
Yes, I did. Yeah, I've been an art dealer. I was an art dealer for 25 years, and I probably worked 80 hours a week for most of that time. I traveled. I was on a plane, probably half the time going here and there. It was very hard work.
And what would you like to show me in this room?
That's a I love this painting. This is a Claudio.
Do you have to?
Yeah, this is a Claudio Bravo, Mexican artist, probably one of the best. That's from 1963, and it's a gouache, which is a opaque watercolor, and pencil. It's a work on paper, but it's just a great thing.
This part of your office area here?
Yeah. This is my office. That's a painting by a former husband named Hank Voss. That's also
his. How many husbands have you had?
Two.
Okay.
And that one is a Diebenkorn, Richard Diebenkorn.
The one in the middle there?
The portrait. And that's the one with the fruit bowl, the still life, is a Paul Wanner. Uh-huh. And they are Bay Area figurative artists. And I came down here from the Bay Area. I was up there for about 22 years. And that's a Bechtel, also from the Bay Area. That's one of Hank Voss's. That's one of Hank's. And those two are by Sandow Burke. And these are sort of the apocalypse in San Francisco. So you see that she's Brigadier General Susan Huang. Despite enormous casualties under heavy bombing, Huang's Loco 23rd Regiment thwarted attempts to round the left flank near Union Square. So these are sort of parodies, but he's a good painter.
So Carol, tell me, why are you running for supervisor?
I originally got interested in politics when I was put in jail a year and a half ago for no reason, and the case was dismissed by the district attorney's office the following day, but I was held in the county jail for 12 hours, and There was an investigation of the sheriff's office, which the district attorney initiated. But I had never been arrested in my life, and I thought it was very...
Kitty's interested in my camera.
Okay. Yeah. But I found it very, very troubling that someone like me, who is does a lot of good things for the community, and people know who I am, and that I'm certainly not a criminal or anything like that, that, you know, these sheriff deputies could put someone in jail with impunity. And
did they say there was some reason, or what?
They said I had a crumbly pill in my handbag, and they said they charged me with felony possession of a controlled dangerous substance. They set my bail at $10,000. They took me to jail. I was released an hour later on my own recognizance because I've never been arrested and I own my house and I don't have a mortgage. And the pill had a prescription, and I gave them the doctor's name and his phone number and the pharmacy where it was filled, and they refused to call. They just wanted to put me in jail. And
so based on that and your dissatisfaction with the system?
That actually was the first thing that piqued that started making me believe things were not quite right around here. That these guys weren't afraid to be abusive to a person like me, which they were. And I thought there's something going on. They're not afraid of being punished for doing things like this. And that alerted me, and I started looking into things. And then I found a fraudulent document that one of the people who is currently sitting in government had filed to get a federal grant, which is a pretty serious crime. And then I started looking into the pensions, and I saw that these things they're not sustainable. And the unions are fighting this tooth and nail. The only way to get rid of pensions liabilities is for the county to declare bankruptcy. But if the county declares bankruptcy, that wipes out all of the municipal bonds. So then you affect a lot of retired people, and people are holding municipal bonds in the county, and it's just a big mess.
And what do you want to do as supervisor if you were elected?
Well, I would push to declare bankruptcy for the county. There's no other way, because it's an unfortunate remedy, but it's the only remedy, because the county right now probably has $5 billion in unfunded pension liabilities. And we don't have that money, and we're never going to have that money. Right now, what politicians in Santa Barbara typically do when in financial hardship times is they start granting building permits indiscriminately. And what they're doing in Goleta, Mike Tobes wants to put up high-density housing there. He stands to make a considerable profit on that. They don't have the infrastructure to support that. None of this is thought about. All the current politicians are thinking about is getting that extra tax revenue from property tax. The Rick Caruso situation on the beach in Montecito at the Miramar, they want him to build that so that they get more tax revenue. So I think that you're going to see a spate of building here that is going to change the tenor and complexion of the county of Santa Barbara forevermore. As you can see, we're outside, and I took up all the grass outside because it uses too much water. So I was trying to conserve water. Getting back to some of these pensions and all the debt that the county has, there are a lot of rich people who live in the Santa Barbara area. But I think what people fail to realize is most of the people who are really rich don't pay taxes in California. They have second homes elsewhere, and that's where they pay taxes. The upshot of this tax burden is going to fall on the middle class here. And another major problem that we have is all of these big box stores that have siphoned all of the business away from small businesses here. And the people who would have had small businesses at one time are now working at a checkout counter, like a robot, up at Target or Costco. And local people should realize that when they shop up there, they're putting the possibility of having a real community in the past. You have to have small business to have a middle class. You have to have small business to support a community so that you're not reliant only on property tax. Now, I do a lot of reading, and I have noticed that a lot of our politicians in the county of Santa Barbara don't do any reading, and I don't think any of them have read any of these books. This is a book called Fiat Money Inflation in France. This is the classic text on inflation and on printing money and on spending money that isn't worth anything. This put set France back for two generations. This is an important thing to know. Being an economist, I was introduced to a book like this, but these are things that all politicians should know about.
You're an economist too?
Yes, I am. I'm a writer now. I don't sell art anymore because nobody's buying it, but I'm an economist. I've read books about, this is by Noam Chomsky's daughter. She's a professor in Salem, Massachusetts. This is called They Take Our Jobs. This is about that issue of jobs.
You have about 1 minute
left. Okay. This is a great book to read, Grapes of Wrath, which is by Steinbeck. And this is about the Depression and when they flooded California with too many, well, these were not exactly immigrants, but they were people from the Midwest. And they brought out five people for every job. And the intent was to suppress wages. And I believe that with the illegal immigrant situation here, that is exactly what rich people here have tried to do, suppress wages by bringing in illegal aliens to work jobs. It's not that the middle class that's already here wouldn't work these jobs, but the wages have been suppressed so dramatically by illegal immigrants that they can't take these jobs anymore because they don't pay enough.
And do you have some concluding comments?
Well, right now, the way I see it, Santa Barbara County is in a prison, imprisoned behind bars because taxes are going to go so sky high. Some of them will be hidden, but this is going to hit the middle class because, as I say, the rich people all have second homes and they pay their taxes in another state. So it's the middle class that always gets hurt by all this deceitfulness.
Okay, well, good luck to you, Carol.
Thank you.
You have been watching Touring with the Candidates, sponsored by the League of Women Voters of Santa Barbara and produced by Larry Nimmer. In addition to programs like this, we sponsor forums, and we also offer information online at our website, www.smartvoter.org. All candidates are invited to present their information online at our website. We hope you have enjoyed this presentation. Remember, you can also vote by mail. For the League of Women Voters of Santa Barbara, I'm Irene Stone, and we'll see you next time.